I was wandering through the Yale bookstore one day about 2 or 3 years ago. I am on the Terry Lectures Committee in my capacity as chair of the Religious Studies Department, and we're always looking for interesting speakers. It's not easy to find people who can talk about both science and religion, or even were willing to talk about science and religion, even when we define those two things, which we have defined very broadly. Religion has come to be almost anything related to human value, and science can be the social sciences, it can be all sorts, it doesn't have to be the hard science, it can be all sorts of things. In part of the endowment says, the object of this foundation is not the promotion of scientific investigation and discovery, but rather the assimilation and interpretation of that which has been or shall be hereafter discovered. This was about 100 years ago, remember. And its application to human welfare, especially by the building of the truths of science and philosophy into the structure of a broadened and purified religion. The founder believes that such a religion will greatly stimulate intelligent effort for the improvement of human conditions and the advancement of the race in strength and excellence of character. To this end, it is desired that a series of lectures be given by men eminent in their respective departments on ethics, the history of civilization and religion, biblical research, all sciences and branches of knowledge which have an important bearing on the subject, all the great laws of nature, especially of evolution, it says especially of evolution, also such interpretations of literature and sociology as are in accord with the spirit of this foundation, to the end that the Christian spirit may be nurtured. I hope your Christian spirit is being nurtured by hearing these comments. In the fullest light of the world's knowledge, and that mankind may be helped to attain its highest possible welfare and happiness on this earth. Now, 100 years is a long time, and things change. And so, obviously, things have changed in the Terry Lectures. We don't really try to make sure that the lecturers advance people's Christian spirit. We don't even think it's appropriate that any kind of religion, much less Christianity in particular, be advanced with these lectures. But when we come up with how to meet the spirit of this endowment and yet come up with people who can speak in intellectually compelling ways to concerns about the relationship between science and religious discourse of our time and in the past and the future, that's not an easy thing to do. When I found David Sloan Wilson's book in the Yale bookstore, I didn't know his work. I stumbled upon it on a table, and the book is called Darwin's Cathedral. And I thought, well, anything named Darwin's Cathedral sounds promising. I picked it up, and I found it a fascinating work, and I also found it an exceptional work in the sense that it challenges, it pushes the reader to come to the very limits of scientific discourse and also religious discourse. For example, we can ask all kinds of questions. What is religion? People on the street have an idea that they know what that is, but actually most people who study religion in religious studies departments, we debate all the time. A lot of us have come to the point we don't think there is any such thing as religion in some kind of broad universal sense. But I'm not a scientist, but I've come to the position that I don't really believe there's any such thing as science either. There doesn't seem to me to be any one particular coherent method of scientific discipline that actually does describe what all practicing scientists seem to do. What is matter, though? Some of our speakers in these things have questioned the category of matter, questioned the category of the physical. Can we talk about religion without using the concept of the supernatural? I think we can, as a person who does religious studies. Can we talk about nature and the world without worrying too much about the precise nature of matter or the physical? A lot of scientists would say so. Do we need metaphysics to have religion? Some of our speakers would clearly say no. Do we have to believe that there are laws of nature in order to be good practicing scientists? One of our speakers, Bas van Frassen, has written quite extensively trying to convince other scientists that there are no such things as laws of nature, or that we don't need them anyway for scientific practice. These are all legitimate questions that take us beyond the practice of either science or religion to talk about the practice of science or religion. They're not questions about what scientists need to believe in order to practice science, nor are they questions believers need to believe in order to practice religion. They are, though, the appropriate questions to be asked in a critical, intellectual environment in which the study of science or religion as practices takes place. David Sloan Wilson's work takes us to the edge of these kinds of questions. One can easily talk about religion as the functional structure of ultimate meaning-making in either atheistic or theistic ways, in either agnostic or believing theological terms. After all, there are extremely old and respectable Christian ways of talking about God while still believing that anything you actually say about God must of necessity be false, at least in some sense. For much Christian theology, not to mention Jewish thought or Buddhist theory, God refers to nothing because God can't be a simple reference of human language. In that sense, God is a limit term. Every statement in either theology or science does indeed say something true in a sense, but they also may be interpreted to say something false in other senses. And in my view, the most profound theological or scientific statements not only say something positive, but also point us to the limit of what we know, maybe even to the limit of what we can even imagine that we know. David Sloan Wilson's work, by taking us to the limits of how to imagine ever new possibilities, evolution doesn't stop, after all, helps us think about both scientific and theological statements in both their limitation and their promise. His work seems, even more than many lectures we have sponsored, to address the relationship between science and religion in a particularly relevant way. And so I'm very happy to introduce David Sloan Wilson, who will be speaking today on the human social organism, how human groups function, or no, not that, groups as, wrong lecture, groups as organisms and organisms as groups, multi-level selection theory and its many applications. Professor Wilson.
Thank you very much. I just realized that last time I had a lapel mic for purposes of the video, but is this going to be sufficient? Fine. Okay. Well, as we just heard, these are deeply philosophical issues, and I think in a very interesting way what Mr. Terry was reaching for way back 100 years ago is actually very relevant. It might have sounded antiquated, but I think that we're coming back around to this level of generality. And another point that I want to make before I begin is that all of this might sound so very abstract and philosophical. There is a level of pragmatism to this, down-to-earth ideas that we associate with science as practiced, which is equally as striking. And I hope that's one of the impressions that you get from this lecture. This lecture will not be about humans. I'm saving humans for Thursday, but I think you will clearly see relevance. So let's dive right in here. I want to begin by something that I call the fundamental problem of social life, and this is an implication of natural selection that emerges at a very elementary level, which is that natural selection within a group is insensitive to the welfare of the group. Now, what does this mean? To see what this means, I want you to consider a little thought experiment, a typical evolutionary experiment where we have two types of individuals. We'll call them A and B. And type A behaves in a way that is nice for everyone. It increases the fitness of everyone in the population, including itself, at no cost to itself. Now, you might think that this is an unrealistic expectation, that there's no free lunch, but for purposes of the experiment, let's just believe that with a wave of my hand, I can cause all of us to survive better than we did before. What this will do is that it will increase the number of individuals in the population, but it will not increase, it will not change the proportion of individuals. And natural selection is all about changing proportions. If my kind is at 1% or 10% or 50%, that's exactly the same percentage that it will be in after this takes place. And so we have not changed the frequency, the composition of the population. If we make the more reasonable assumption that benefiting everyone in the group has involved some personal cost on my part, then my fitness is going to be lower than everyone else's. And my frequency, my proportionality, even though that I've done this service, is going to be less. And as we iterate that generation after generation, unless we add something to this story, the solid citizens of the world will go extinct and the slackers will inherit the earth. And this is at such an elementary level that that this observation can be made. It's an illustration that I tried to make in my first lecture of just how profound Darwin's theory was, even at the most rudimentary level, to make this kind of implication. So here we have this problem. Evolution can evolve all sorts of wonderful adaptations, the wonderful insect that resembles the leaf and the fish that glides through the water so effortlessly. But when it comes to these social behaviors, other-oriented behaviors, which we could call altruism or cooperation, or I like to call them solid citizen behaviors, there's something very disturbingly insensitive about natural selection, at least within a single group. Now, Darwin was... So this all follows from the fact that fitness is a relative concept. It's based on relative fitness. It doesn't matter how many offspring, how well you survive and reproduce. It only matters that you do so better than the alternative types in the population. And this illustrates a theme of my previous lecture, which is when it comes to adaptations, be careful what you wish for. The biological concept of adaptation is not just the idea of goodness or benefit. It leads to many things which are detrimental from an everyday standpoint. Now, Darwin was familiar with this problem, and he had a solution. And let me read it to you in Darwin's own words. Darwin, I think, among other things, was a wonderful prose writer. And here he's talking about the problem of moral traits in humans, things like honesty and loyalty. And he appreciated that these traits do not seem to have an advantage within single groups. So he says, "It must not be forgotten that although a high standard of morality gives but a slight or no advantage to each individual man and his children over other men of the same tribe, yet that an increase in the number of well-endowed men and advancement in the standard of morality will certainly give an immense advantage to one tribe over another. There can be no doubt that a tribe, including many members who, from possessing in a high degree the spirit of patriotism, fidelity, obedience, courage, and sympathy, were always ready to aid one another and to sacrifice themselves for the common good, would be victorious over most other tribes. And this would be natural selection." So to put it in modern terms, this is the seed of multi-level selection theory. And it's so simple. One of the points that I want to make is that although all theories become complicated in their details, but the basic element of this theory is so simple. I illustrated it on Tuesday with a funny little thought experiment involving a desert island scenario. Here are the two relationships. Slackers beat solid citizens within groups, and groups of solid citizens beat groups of slackers. And so it's possible, at least in principle, for solid citizens to evolve by a process of between-group selection. If we have a population of groups and they vary in the proportion of solid citizens, then those with the most are going to differentially contribute to the gene pool and will have a process of selection at the group level favoring group-level adaptations, which can counter selection within groups favoring these traits that we associate with cheating and exploitation and slacking. Here's a numerical example just to show you that it works if we plug in numbers. In this example, we begin with two groups, equal size, 100 individuals. And in this group, we put in 20% solid citizens. And in this group, we put in 80% solid citizens. And what these individuals do is they produce a public good at some cost to themselves. And what that means is that in this group, the group has become larger, but the proportion of the solid citizens has declined from 0.2 to 0.184. So that slice of the green, that dark slice is becoming narrower. In this group, the same thing happens. This group becomes bigger, but this slice, this black slice, has gone from 0.8 to 0.787 because within each and every group, the solid citizens are doing less well than the slackers. But there's another force. This group, which has more solid citizens, has become larger than this group. And so they don't even have to compete in any direct fashion. It doesn't have to be by warfare. If they simply add their members to the total gene pool, what we find is that this difference, the difference in the size of the group, overcompensates for the disadvantage within groups. And in the total population, the frequency of solid citizens has gone from 0.5 to 0.516. They've increased in frequency despite the fact that they've decreased in frequency within each and every group. And that's because we have this process of group selection, which is opposing the process of within individual selection. So this idea is so very simple. I think all of you, regardless of whether you're scientists or not, can can easily appreciate what's going on here. Does it solve the fundamental problem of social life? That depends on the relative strength of these two opposing forces. And three things can happen. Within-group selection can be stronger, in which case the slackers prevail. Between-group selection can be stronger, in which case the solid citizens prevail. Or you can have a variety of frequency-dependent processes which result in very interesting mixes of individuals in the population, where there's an equilibrium point in which we have a certain number of slackers, a certain proportion of solid citizens, which are maintained at a certain frequency in the population. And this can be a very common outcome. So that is the theory of multi-level selection, very simple in its details. Now I need to tell you about the history of multi-level selection, which is anything but simple. And it's a wonderful history. It's something that I could spend a long time on, but I'm going to zip through it. And I'm very happy to talk about this either in person or on the website. So what we can say is this. Darwin, as I've shown you, wrote and thought very clearly about the subject. He appreciated the fundamental problem of social life, and he proposed his solution. The great fathers of population genetics, Fisher, Wright, and Haldane, they also wrote clearly about the problem, but only very briefly. And one point that you have to appreciate is that as important as this subject is, it was eclipsed by even more important subjects during the early days of evolutionary theory, because we had the nature of heredity to understand. The whole consequences of Mendelian genetics, there were so many things, basic things that had to be understood, that this particular problem, as important as it is, only received cursory treatment by the architects of population genetics theory. As for most biologists, they did not share the clarity of Darwin, Fisher, Wright, and Haldane. And very often what they did was assume uncritically that natural selection simply promotes goodness. And so it will increase the fitness of individuals, social groups, species, ecosystems. Natural selection just makes things good without any reason to distinguish among levels of selection. And in those discussions, when the fundamental problem was acknowledged, then very typically there was an assumption that between-group selection would prevail over within-group selection. And so the final result was that you would get species, basically, that evolved to prevent their own extinction, and a spirit of all for one and one for all in terms of social groups. And this is called naive group selection. And it prevailed. It was quite common up until the middle of the 20th century. And at this point, enter George Williams. George C. Williams lives right across the sound at SUNY Stony Brook. And George has been my ideological enemy for 30 years. And he's also been a warm personal friend of mine for 30 years. I first met him that long ago. I marched into his office as a brash young graduate student, and I said, I'm going to convince you about group selection. And George looked at me, and he offered me a postdoc on the spot, which I didn't take because I had other things to do. And just recently, because George is getting on in years, just before I came here, I had a wonderful adventure when I went with my wife and Will Provine, who's a wonderful historian of biology at Cornell. And we hopped in the car, and we drove down to Stony Brook, where George and his wife Doris are staying at a retirement home. And we spent 2 days getting an oral history from George Williams about his life and all of these issues. We had just the greatest time, and that's where I've come from to give these lectures. And the story, as George tells it, is that he got his degree at UCLA, and then he did a postdoc at the University of Chicago, which was a hotbed for this kind of naive group selection thinking. And he went to a lecture by Alfred Emerson, who was a very famous biologist at the time. And Emerson was talking about all of nature as if it was like a termite colony. And George left the lecture with Doris, and he turned to her and he said, something must be done. And then 8 years later, actually, was the book Adaptation and Natural Selection, one of the great modern classics, published by Princeton University Press. Now, what did George actually do? He did two things. The first thing he did was establish the relevance of multi-level selection for a broad audience. He took the clarity that already existed in Darwin and the population geneticists, and he made this accessible to a broad audience. In this sense, he was a popularizer, and he says this himself. The second thing he did was make an empirical claim that between-group selection is almost invariably weak compared to within-group selection and can essentially be ignored. And it's very, very important to distinguish between these two accomplishments. Here it is in his own words. This is one of the canonical passages from Adaptation and Natural Selection. He said, it is universally conceded by those who have seriously concerned themselves with this problem that group-related adaptations must be attributed to the natural selection of alternative groups of individuals, and that natural selection of alternative individuals within populations will be opposed to this development. I am in entire agreement with the reasoning behind this conclusion. Only by a theory of between-group selection could we achieve a scientific explanation of group-related adaptations. Here he is affirming the truth of multi-level selection theory. If you're going to talk about for the good of the group, you must provide a process of group selection. However, I would question one of the premises on which this reasoning is based. Chapters 5 to 8 will be primarily a defense of the thesis that group-related adaptations do not, in fact, exist. So here is the empirical claim that although multi-level selection is a great theory, it's what we need to determine if something can be for the good of the group and evolve. The empirical claim is that it can't. So these are the two parts of what George established very effectively in 1966, along with others. And this ushered the age of individualism in evolutionary biology, as I like to think of it. Now a good 40 years old, and so most everyone here has been brought up in this tradition. Either you were present when it happened, or you were brought up in this tradition. And it involves the following elements. First of all, the rejection of group selection. Almost as strongly as Lamarckism was this celebrated in the literature, that group selection is such a false way of thinking that we can bury it alongside Lamarck. And so multi-level selection theory, because we can forget about the higher levels of selection, it becomes the theory of individual selection. There's something that's privileged about the individual of the biological hierarchy. Of course, we have all this stuff out there in nature which does appear to be nice and cooperative that we need to explain. And the theories that arose to explain that were, of course, the theories of kin selection and reciprocity. But these were envisioned as some kind of, not to involve group selection, but to be some kind of an expanded form of self-interest, so that when an animal helped its relatives, it was maximizing its inclusive fitness. It was increasing the fitness of its genes in the bodies of others. And when it was engaging in reciprocity, it was I scratch your back, if you scratch mine, you're helping others in the expectation that they would help you in return. And so with these theories, then everything that evolved became a form of self-interest. And then as a separate development, there was a further reduction, which was initiated by Williams and then continued and expanded by Richard Dawkins, so that now it seemed that everything would evolve at the gene level, and that everything that evolved could somehow be interpreted in terms of selfish genes. Okay, so that is a miniature history of the group selection. And now, what I need to show you is that group selection has been revived. If you look at the modern literature, what you'll find is that it's back. And I'll spend the rest of my lecture demonstrating to you that multi-level selection theory, as I have described it to you, is now alive and well. And to see how something, this might seem so extraordinary, because how could something be rejected as strongly as multi-level selection theory and then make such a comeback? And the reason that we can make this sensible is when we return to this idea that that Williams did two things. He affirmed the basic theory of multi-level selection, and then he made the empirical claim that group selection simply is never very strong. If the first claim is right and the second claim is wrong, then what can we do? What must we do than to go back and evaluate the relative importance of within and between group selection on a case-by-case basis? If we can't just say it never happens, if it sometimes happens, if it happens quite often, what can we do but go back to the theoretical framework of multi-level selection. It's the only alternative, because one deserves to survive. The only thing that's changed is the evaluation of two. Now, why did the empirical claim prove to be incorrect? There's two reasons. The first reason is that the alternative theories, kin selection and reciprocity, which is now studied virtually entirely in terms of evolutionary game theory mathematically, when you look at them, it turns out that they themselves are multi-level selection processes. And so although they do explain how altruism evolves, it is false to say that they are alternatives to multi-level selection. It turns out that they're special cases of multi-level selection. And I'll illustrate that very briefly in a minute for game theory. And always happy to talk about all of these things in more detail. So at the very least, we need to say that group selection happens in those cases that we've already explained in terms of kin selection and evolutionary game theory. But in addition to that, it turns out that group selection can be important under conditions which have not been identified by these two theories, in particular in large groups of unrelated individuals, and even, believe it or not, whole ecosystems can be units of selection, as I will briefly attempt to show you. So let me try to substantiate these claims in the time that I have available. So why are kin selection and reciprocity themselves forms of group selection? It's a biological fact that social interactions almost always take place amongst individuals that are very small in number compared to the total population. If you just look at any social interaction, what you'll find is that they take place in groups that are relatively small compared to the total population. This is a biological fact, and no theory can avoid that fact and hope to say anything true about the evolution of social behavior. And so kin selection and evolutionary game theory, when you look at them, they involve multi-group populations, basically, and they must in order to be realistic. And as soon as you identify the groups that exist within these theories, then it becomes clear that the behaviors that count as cooperative and that evolve in these models are selectively disadvantageous within groups and evolve only on the strength of group selection as envisioned by Darwin. Now, let me show you in the case for evolutionary game theory. Now, some of you know this well. Others probably don't know it well. But in evolutionary game theory, it's a kind of a Darwinian world in which individuals employ different strategies, and they meet up. And in the simplest form of evolutionary game theory, it's pairwise interactions. Okay, the groups can be of any size. That's N-person game theory. But most game theory is two-person game theory, in which case the social interactions just occur as dyads. Okay? And one thing that you can do, and this is a cooperative situation, is just you're a cheater. You don't cooperate, and if somebody's nice to you, you get the benefit, and you don't return it. That's called defect. Tit for tat is a fairly sophisticated strategy which follows a little if-then rule, which says this. It says, I'm going to start out nice. When I meet someone, we form a pair, we're going to interact a number of times. I'm going to start out nice, and thereafter I'm going to imitate my partner. That's tit for tat. And tit for tat is a very successful strategy. It's the strategy that tends to evolve in these game theory models. Now, if you look at that strategy, what you can see very easily is that tit for tat never beats its own partner. If it's faced with another nice strategy, they're nice during the first time, and they continue to be nice for their whole relationship. In that case, they tie. If it meets a defect, the first time, tit for tat loses, and thereafter it imitates the defect, and they don't cooperate anymore. And so over the whole interaction, it's lost. And so tit for tat, this wonderful, successful strategy, never beats its own partner. And the only reason that it's a successful strategy is that pairs of tit for tat, pairs of nice strategy, do better than mixed pairs, which in turn do better than pairs of defectors. It's only by the differential contribution of the pairs that this strategy works. And you can take any theory of the evolution of cooperation, find the groups that are assumed by those theories, and simply do that simple comparison of compare the fitnesses within the groups and between the groups, and you'll discover that the fundamental problem of social life is present in each and every one of those theories. is that there's a local disadvantage of being nice, and the only thing that causes those theories to evolve is because groups, clusters of niceness, basically, perform well compared to other clusters which aren't so nice. And so all of these models, it turns out, are miniature versions of multi-level selection theory. And believe it or not, this began to emerge in the 1970s, a long time ago. A wonderful history about W.D. Hamilton, who, of course, was the inventor of kin selection, inclusive fitness theory. Only a few years after he formulated this theory, in which he thought of it as an alternative to group selection, he met an enigmatic man named George Price. And George Price had come up with a new framework, which has become known as the Price equation, which elegantly partitions selection into within and between group components. And George Price spoke to Hamilton, and he said, "Have you seen what my equation does for group selection?" And Hamilton said, "No." He thought that he'd rejected group selection. And when Hamilton reformulated his theory according to the Price equation, he discovered that his own theory had groups and that the altruistic trait in a sibling group, the altruistic sibling is less fit than its selfish brother, and that you have to have a group structure in order to solve that. That took place in the 1970s, and yet still we have this long, long history of the rejection of group selection. It's really an amazing history. So I like to think of the history of multi-level selection as like the Three Stooges moving a piano. After a lot of hard work, we're more or less back to where we started. And so what I want to do is I want to ask you just to keep this fundamental two relationships in mind. Slackers beat solid citizens within groups, and groups of solid citizens beat groups of slackers. And now what I want to do is to show you some of the applications in which this dynamic, this conflict between levels of selection, is being applied in biological systems. And then a whole new field where we can find it in microbes. Just wonderful works on microbial interactions showing levels of selection. And some of these are highly relevant to disease virulence, because if you look at the population structure of any disease organisms, what is it? It's a multi-level population structure in which we're the groups. The host is the groups. And when we think of being nice and slacking and cheating in the context of a disease organism, what the slacker is the individual that's wasting the host to the long-term detriment of the parasite group and, of course, to the detriment of the host. And so this translates very forcefully into something that matters to us, which is how detrimental to diseases become to their hosts. And then an amazing development that took place after the rejection of group selection, called the major transition of life, which some of you might know about, in which evolution takes place in two ways. One is by mutational change, that's the way we've always known about, but another way is by social groups becoming so integrated that they become new higher level organisms in their own right. And some of you are probably familiar with Lynn Margulis's theory of the symbiotic cell, where if you look at our mitochondria and the chloroplast of plants and probably other organelles, what you find is that those were free-living bacteria in the distant past. And so what we are is a symbiotic community of bacteria that have become so integrated that we see the whole more than the parts. And so not only are groups like individuals and being in their members cooperating, but individuals are literally the groups of past ages. All of this took place since the rejection of group selection. And now that this has developed, the origin of life has fallen into this, something called hypercycles. Social insects are being seen as a major transition. And then, of course, we really need to think about human evolution from this perspective, for which I will devote an entire lecture. So all of these things can be understood in terms of this very simple dynamic of selection within and among groups. Now let me try to flesh some of these out. Whenever the discussion becomes too abstract, one should talk about chickens. Gary Larson knows that, and so do I. So chickens live in groups, always have. In modern poultry industry, the chickens are crowded into cages of 9 or 12 hens. And so imagine that we're a poultry breeder and we want to increase egg productivity. In both cases, we have lots of hens, lots of cages of hens. And we're going to select in two ways. In the first experiment, we're going to find the most productive hen within each cage, and we're going to use those hens to breed the next generation. In the second case, we're going to monitor the productivity of entire cages, and we're going to produce the most, we're going to pick the most productive cages, and we'll use all the hens in those cages in order to breed the next generation of hens. Now, it might seem that we're sort of selecting for the same thing in both cases, and that the first experiment would be more successful, because after all, it's individuals who produce eggs, and by focusing on the most productive individual in each cage, wouldn't that be more efficient than the clumsy way of choosing groups, in which case some of the individuals within the groups might not be so productive. But as it turns out, and if you think about multi-level selection, and you can see that we're actually selecting for different traits in these two experiments. And in the first experiment, we're selecting for psychopathy. This is the actual result of the first experiment of within-group selection. And what you see here in the first place is only a few hens because they've murdered the other ones. And they themselves have had their feathers plucked out because aggression is so high. And this is, a picture says more than 1,000 words, but this actually says nothing more than what I said in words, that natural selection within groups is insensitive to the welfare of the group, and that if a hen can achieve her productivity by suppressing the productivity of other hens, then she's the one that gets selected, and then she has aggressive offspring, and things get worse. It's paradoxically, it seems like negative heritability that you select the most productive hens, but the traits that you're selecting when they become common cause everyone to be less productive. So natural selection within groups is insensitive to the welfare of the groups. If we continue this experiment, it will only get worse. And here's the result of between group selection. These are happy chickens. They want to be your neighbor. I like to think of them as Mr. Rogers chickens. And because we're selecting for cooperative interactions, and we're selecting those interactions at the group level, that's how we get the selection for productivity in hens. And this is, in fact, the method that's used to select for egg productivity in hens. So you can thank the eggs in your icebox for group selection. Okay. Now let's try a very similar experiment. This is an experiment that we did, which is just like the last one, except it's performed on ecosystems. So in this experiment, what we're going to do is we're going to have a bunch of microbial microcosms, which are basically test tubes with growth medium, and we're going to put in a little dash of a toxic compound called chloroanilin, and then we're going to add some microorganisms. And what we're going to do is add 2 milliliters of pond water from a single well-mixed source. We're going to squirt in 2 milliliters of pond water into each of these test tubes. Now, how many microbes do you think are in 2 milliliters of pond water? Millions and millions of microbes, probably billions of microbes. Then we let them incubate for 4 days, and then we measure them. And we don't measure anything about the organisms. We measure the degree to which this toxic compound has been degraded. So we're actually measuring a property of the ecosystem, an abiotic property of the environment, which has been changed by this microbial community. And then what we want to do is we want to select those which have been best at degrading the compound, and we'll use those as the parents to inoculate a new generation of ecosystems. And we'll see if we get a response to selection. Now, if you imagine this experiment, ask yourself the question, why should these test tubes vary? Why should these microcosms vary if they've been inoculated with so many microbes? If you know something about sampling error, you know, is that when you colonize groups with very small numbers of individuals, then you know that they're expected to vary. But if you colonize them with millions and millions of individuals, why should they vary at all? Why shouldn't they be just alike? And the answer is, first of all, the empirical answer is that they vary substantially. And the reason for that is because of complex interactions. We know that the weather has something called sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Sometimes it's called the butterfly effect. And what it means is that when a system is complex, and if you have two systems which are only a little bit different from each other, and that's the case in these experiments, these test tubes start out only a tiny bit different from each other. But those differences don't stay small. They become the seed for larger differences and larger differences. And for the same reason that you can't predict the weather, you can't really predict. You get divergence in these trajectories. And what that gives you is variation, phenotypic variation. The first thing that you need, the reason that something like ecosystem selection appeared heretical and impossible, was the first thing people said back then, how can ecosystems vary? How can any population vary if it's been colonized by large numbers of individuals? And all of that reasoning took place before the complexity revolution. And once we have complex, I mean, they don't even have to be very complex. Once we have interacting agents, then this almost always results in spatial heterogeneity. This is a paper by that appeared in Trends in Ecology and Evolution a few years ago by Craig Johnson and Martin Borlas on a similar process, in which basically what they have is a model with these kinds of complex interactions, and the spatial distribution it gives you is this kind of computer art that you're all familiar with, but that's actually the variation in the composition of these communities. And this is a new kind of variation for natural selection to operate on. So the whole science of complexity and its implications for natural selection is something that's taken place since the rejection of group selection. Now, here are some examples from the field. This is a wonderful example that's been worked out for lions. And it's very, very similar to the scenario that Darwin proposed in the passage that I read. So Darwin, for humans, thought that there might be brave individuals and less brave individuals for which you needed group selection. And this is actually the case with lions, that if you study them, you find big individual differences. When there's a fight, always the same individuals go to the fight, the same individuals hang back. And so we have cowardly lions and brave hearts within the same pride. And they studied them and studied them, trying to find an advantage for the brave lions within the pride. They could not find it. And so their conclusion here, and just think of this in parallel with the passage that I read of Darwin. Female lions share a common resource, the territory, but only a proportion of females pay the full cost of territorial defense. If too few females accept the responsibility of leadership, the territory will be lost. You need those cooperators, those solid citizens, in order to maintain the group. If enough females cooperate to defend the range, their territory is maintained, but their collective effort is vulnerable to abuse by their companions, the slackers. Leaders do not gain additional benefits from leading, but they do provide an opportunity for laggards to gain a free ride. So here is this dynamic of within-group selection and between-group selection playing itself out, not just in the laboratory, but in the field. Here's an example I'll bet you don't know about. Voting in African buffalo. This is a wonderful work by a wildlife biologist in Holland called, and the subtitle of this book is Social Inequality and Decision Making. Some of you might be saying, "Wah, what's going on here?" And he said, I studied this, I looked at these animals for 2 years before I knew what was going on. And what happens is, it's the heat of the day, they're resting, they're going to forage at night, and in the late afternoon, only adult females, one stands up and gazes and adopts a particular posture and gazes in a certain direction and then sits down. Then another one gets up and gazes in a certain direction and sits down. And this was slow enough so that he could actually measure the compass orientation of all of these cows. And he discovered that it predicted with remarkable accuracy not where they would head off that night, but where they would end up. And so what that means is that these buffalo have a mental map of their home range, and they're actually voting in order to see where they're going to go that night. Now, this is a wonderful example because in the first place, it's a public good that's being generated. Everyone's going to go there, and everyone's going to benefit or not from going to a better or a worse spot. It's also something that doesn't cost very much. So it comes pretty close to being a low-cost public good. But you need something like group selection in order to explain how such a thing, which is benefiting everyone, is going to evolve in a situation like this. Something very similar might be going on right in our backyard. These are American toad tadpoles, which I study, and also David Skelly at Yale University. And we're now currently trying to document that the very same thing is going on. What these individuals do is they're monitoring their patchy environment, and they're actually communicating with each other through surface waves, and they're concentrating on the best resource. And of course, the champions of this are the social insects. The social insects, just the most wonderful work on how something like a honeybee colony monitors its floral resources over an area of several square miles. And this has been known for a long, long time. But the question is, how do social insect colonies do this? Is this group selection or is this kin selection? And in the 60s, when group selection was rejected, then social insect colonies, evolution, was portrayed as evolving by kin selection. It was thought to be very much involved with their particular genetic system of haplodiploidy. And all of this now is being revised, among others, by the other Wilson, E.O. Wilson, and his colleague Bert Holdobler. They have a paper that's just coming out in which they're going to now be using colony-level selection as the main principle here. And this will also be the subject of their forthcoming book called, appropriately, The Superorganism. So the way that social insect colonies have been interpreted for a very long time is now we're returning to that interpretation. Now, microbes are an area in which these ideas are being played out much more recently, and microbes are turning out to be incredibly sophisticated. This is one well-known example. This is the cellular slime mold. It's an amoeba which alternates between a solitary stage of the life cycle where it just goes around to single cells. And then when times are hard, they stream together and they form this little slug here. This slug actually migrates as a single body. It's photosensitive. And then when it gets to the right place, it builds itself into this tower and this ball of spores, and the tower is non-reproductive. So some individuals are sacrificing their lives in order to for these individuals to reproduce. Slime molds became famous by John Bonner as model systems in developmental biology, and thousands of papers were written without ever appreciating the fundamental problem of social life, that there might be a problem of cheating, and that this system might have to do something about the problem of cheating. And only within the last 5 or 10 years have various groups, especially down at Rice University, David Queller and Joan Strassman, started to work hard on this from a multi-level perspective. There's other wonderful examples. I'll just give you one. This is work by Paul Rainey, and all of these articles are appearing regularly in journals such as Nature. What Paul showed is that there's a bacteria which forms a mat on the surface of the water. And what that enables it to do is to gain access to oxygen. But this mat is expensive to make, because what you have to do is secrete a polysaccharide, which is expensive to produce. So there's the mat, and you get mutations, cheaters, who don't produce this polysaccharide, and so they get to reproduce faster than the others. They spread through the mat disintegrates, everything falls down to the bottom. So it's a perfect scenario for multi-level selection, with both within and between group selection. And in the system, both types are maintained in the population. So you have these two forces result in a stable equilibrium. But you have to study it from a multi-level perspective. Okay, Major Transitions in Evolution. This is a book by John Maynard Smith and Urs Svathmari. And I've already mentioned the basic dynamics, so I'm eager to wrap up for questions here. So the idea here is that in addition to evolution by mutational change, we have evolution by social groups becoming so integrated that they become higher-level organisms in their own right. One interesting... a major transition, what it requires, this balance between levels of selection, within group selection and between group selection, the balance between them, their relative strengths, can itself evolve. And a major transition occurs when you get the evolution of mechanisms that restrict within-group selection and concentrate selection at the between-group level. Here's a cartoon of this. This is supposed to be a primordial cell prior to the evolution of chromosomes, in which the genes are autonomous units. And the black genes are solid citizen genes. They're participating in the economy of the cell. The red gene is a selfish gene, and it's now replicating. It's using the resources of the cell to replicate, and so it's increasing in frequency within the cell. So this is the eternal struggle between levels of selection. A solution to this is the evolution of the chromosome, which is to take the genes and to bind them into a single structure which must reproduce as a unit. So the chromosome neatly solves the problem of within-group selection and concentrates natural selection at the between-group level. Now the only way that this assemblage of genes can evolve is by causing them as a collectivity to do better than other cells. And EvoS at this university in 1988 published a book called The Evolution of Individuality, which is a hugely influential book that sets some of this thinking in motion. A major transition is never entirely complete. And what that means is that if you take even organisms such as us, and most of our genes cause us to function as individuals. It's amazing what we can do as individuals. But there are genes within us that, like the slackers and the cheaters, they spread. That's why they're still in the population. But they spread at the expense of the collective, not by causing the collective to do better. And so there's a class of diseases which are not foreign. They're not organisms that invade us. They are part of us. They're simply the cheaters that are still with us at a low frequency in this process of multi-level selection. Okay, well, I have just flown through a lot of material, but let me summarize them. And what I would like to think is that the basic ideas are sufficiently simple so that you can have basically easily gotten the basics of all of these examples that I have presented so briefly. But here's a summary of major points. First of all, the fundamental problem of social life as something which emerges at a very elementary level from evolutionary theory. This was not obvious before. And I'll show you on Thursday that in the social sciences, this awareness certainly was not obvious before. So evolution, in the first place, says we've got a huge problem if we want to understand groups as adaptive units, society as something which is basically cooperative. This does not emerge automatically from evolutionary theory the way individual level adaptations do. And this is true for any creature. Secondly, multi-level selection is a partial solution. And I really want to drive home the simplicity of multi-level selection. The rejection of multi-level selection and its revival, and once again, let me just iterate, why is it possible? How is it possible for a theory like this to be revived as completely as it has? And that's because that what George did was two things, and what's changed is only one of them. That first point of the basic correctness, the logical consistency and correctness of multi-level selection theory was something which was affirmed by Wilson, by Williams, and remains correct. So this is something which deserves to be retained from adaptation and natural selection. But the claim that group selection is invariably weak, that's what can be rejected, which automatically revives group selection. Finally, multi-level selection simplifies evolutionary theory by subsuming previous theories. If you've gone through, if you're an evolutionary biologist and you've taken a course in social behavior, you get kin selection theory, you get game theory, you get selfish gene theory. You're told that group selection doesn't work. All these theories, and it's a tremendous simplification to see all of these special cases of evolution in multi-group populations in which the dynamic that's going on is this conflict between within and between group selection. It can be applied to an extraordinary range of phenomenon, and most remarkably, for in a field in which it was said for so long that we cannot think of groups as like organisms, that groups are nothing more than what organisms do to each other in the process of maximizing their self-interest. Now it appears that organisms are themselves the groups of past ages. That's how completely multi-level selection has been revived. And all of this serves as background for a passage such as this. And this is a passage written by a member of the Hutterite faith 350 years ago, 1650, which says, "True love means growth for the whole organism, whose members are all interdependent and serve each other. That is the outward form of the inner working of the spirit, the organism of the body governed by Christ. We see the same thing among the bees who all work with equal zeal, gathering honey. So in this passage, a religious believer is comparing his communities to single organisms and social insect colonies. And the question is, can this be treated as a serious scientific hypothesis? Is there some sense in which we can explain human groups in general and religious groups in particular, taking us closer to what Mr. Terry might have had in mind, we'll never know. Is this something that can be treated as a serious scientific hypothesis? Can we think of human sociality and something as seemingly far away from evolutionary theory as the nature of religious groups? And can that be added to the long list of applications, just as all of these non-human systems? So thank you very much.
The timing of the difficulties that group selection had coincided with a certain political activity in this country. Do you think that the taint that social Darwinism has carried over to the distaste for group selection?
That's a great question, and I'm actually going to begin my lecture on Thursday by a miniature review of individualism in the social sciences. What I'll say is that if you look at the social sciences, you find roughly the same transition in which our groupish and holistic and sort of organicist views of human society were complete common sense. And there was no one who didn't hold these views. If you look at people like Durkheim and Wundt, the concept of society as an organism was complete common sense back then. That gave rise to the tradition of functionalism in the social sciences, which was more or less independent of anything taking place in biology. And then around the middle of the 20th century, functionalism was abandoned, and approaches which are loosely called methodological individualism became the vogue, and so that the social sciences became individualistic at the same time as evolution, with very few connections between them. And so I don't know if it was social Darwinism. If it was, it would have happened in evolution and not in the social sciences. But I do think that something happened in a broad cultural sense which was driving what was taking place scientifically in these different fields. And I think I would love a social history of this time to be written.
I'd like just add something to that, not part of a question, but it may be related that at the time in some of the social sciences that functionalism came under severe critique, precisely because it seemed always to be overly optimistic and come up with a positive end. You know, the organism was always assumed to function well, and that automatically seemed to dismiss the possibility for true conflict, and some people even accuse it of being able to enervate any kind of conflict that might lead to progressive politics. So a lot of the argument against functionalism in some of the social sciences came from people on the left who said it is inherently overly conservative as a way of thinking about human society and change. And so those very things that have kept hold of some kind of aspect of functionalism, the only way they've done that is by integrating notions of conflict into the functionalism
right.
itself, which is precisely what you're talking about.
It was just the kind of naive group selection that
exactly.
that was taking place in biology. And it was just, it had no means to determine whether or why something might be functional or not. And what's remarkable about this theory is that this is the first time, really, we have a basis for deciding whether something might be functional or might not. I apply this to the study of religion. If you look at all of the different theories of religion, they can actually be classified into theories which call religion functional in some sense or not. And there's a bunch that basically portray religion as dysfunctional. If it's functional, it can be at the group level. It can be for the good of the group. It could be a form of exploitation, some individuals, not others. It can be a cultural parasite. So what's interesting about this is that we have the theory includes multiple plausible alternatives and the means for deciding among them. And that's different than anything which is so bloated that anything that happens, you just categorize it as a single thing. So that's very important, and I wager that it's the first time that we've had something like this. Sir? The simple thing to do if you want to ask a question is just to come down, and then you can be ready.
I was wondering what happened to V.C. Wynn Edwards in your story, and whether in the post-G.C. Williams era that you've chronicled here, Wynn Edwards' arguments have been revisited and have been rehabilitated.
Yes, thank you for asking that question. The history is interesting. Most people think that Williams wrote his book as a response to Wynn Edwards, but his book was in progress when Wynn Edwards' book came out. And of course, then Williams accommodated the book to include Wynn Edwards. And Wynn Edwards, you know, one of the things that I think is interesting for the historian of science is the degree to which these controversies become simplified so that the people become sort of iconic. And there's some sense in which, the way I think about it is that the history turns into a kind of a symbolic system for telling you how to think and how not to think, for which you need a relatively few actors on the stage, so that when Edwards became the great whipping boy, basically, for how not to, what not to do. Now, when Edwards was a naive group selectionist, so he had a very grandiose theory that animals evolved to regulate their population size to avoid overexploiting their resources. That's Wynn Edwards' thesis. And as group selection has struggled back to become legitimate again, most people would just not even want to go near to say that Wynn Edwards' hypothesis has something to recommend it. But since I'm a fool, it's not going to be revived in its grandiose form. But the basic concept that organisms might regulate their population size is a perfectly feasible hypothesis. We have some very good empirical evidence in parasites. And in fact, the whole concept of the evolution of reduced virulence in diseases is nothing more than Wynn Edwards' hypothesis. If a disease organism evolves to be less virulent than it could be, so that as a group it can send out more propagules, what would that be but regulating your population size to avoid overexploiting your resource? And no one wants to say that. It's just pathetic. And then just recently, within the last year, Yanir Baryam, a system scientist, published a paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, a very nice agent-based computer simulation model, which actually demonstrates the feasibility of this kind of signaling to reduce your resources and shows how it can be maintained by the very kind of spatial heterogeneity that's caused this kind of computer art kind of heterogeneity is sufficient to maintain this. And so Wynn Edwards deserves to be, not Wynn Edwards as a person, but the hypothesis is a very sensible hypothesis, and it might be true some of the time.
I wanted to ask you how you thought group selection reflected on the process of speciation and thoughts about how that occurred, maybe at different stages of evolution, of the evolution of evolutionary thought.
Right. So there's many units that can serve as units of selection. And one such unit would be relatively small social groups, minimally a dyad, okay? That's what two-person game theory is. There can be larger social groups, there can be multi-species groups, as I discussed with ecosystems, or it can be species. And the concept of species selection is among the subjects. It's a somewhat complicated issue, and if I were to say just one thing, I would say that the concept of a species as a unit of selection is actually quite different than the concept of a social group or an ecosystem as a unit of selection, because in the latter case, you actually have multiple groups, and they're actually competing with each other in some sense for space or future patches or something like that. In the case of species selection, as it's often rendered, what you get is you get taxonomic groups, which are groups in your own mind, but they're not actually physically interacting groups often. And so it's more abstract and not as obvious that it works as well as the other kinds of groups. So.
More of a comment again rather than a question, and somewhat off the point of group selection, but in addition to members of the group actually participating in things like population regulation, there are synorganismic guilds which, of course, through parasites, can regulate predators and prey. There are those beautiful examples of the parasites in the African gazelles, which are when the gazelle population is very high, infect many of the gazelles. The lions, of course, eat the gazelles and are so infected, and that drops the population of lions. There are many of these feedbacks, not simply at the same taxonomic or within group level, but syngametic and synorganismic guilds that form. And you're looking at one aspect, of course, and one level, but I think very important in your insights is that there is a nested hierarchy of relationships, each of which has emergent properties at those various hierarchical levels.
Yeah, and the extent to which, I mean, you're always going to have complex systems, regardless of whether they're functional systems. And in order to find out if any of these higher level systems, be they single species or multiple species, acquires the properties of adaptation, you really have to think hard about what's called the population structure. And in familiar terms, the concept of a public good, because at the heart of all of this are traits which have effects that affect sets of individuals. And that creates the problem that we've talked about. If it affects a set of individuals, then what's happening to the proportionality of the traits within that set? So that can take place. Certainly the distinction between within species and between species is not a material distinction in this case, because if your public good affects you plus other species, that's fine. That's still the kind of problem that we're dealing with. But in my advocacy of group selection, I don't want to make it appear that group selection is everywhere. What's nice about this theory is that it enables us to say when it happens and when it doesn't happen. There's many, many situations in which group selection is indeed a weak force, and then the system becomes dominated by within-group selection. It's the ability to say, at least in principle, when we get the alternatives that saves us, I think, or that keeps it a proper scientific theory.
There are no more questions. Let's thank our speaker.